done this quite a few times. I always have my kids involved, so this time I'm doing it without them, so there's not very much background noise.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal.
Now on here you have two options. You have the option to do cinematic, where you just sit back and watch it. Pretty good for educational purposes. And then you have interactive, where when you do dock and land, you're in full control, either with the Vive controls, keyboard, or some sort of gamepad. I'm going to use the Vive controls.
No man can fully grasp how far and how fast we have come. But condense, if you will, the 50,000 years of man's recorded history in a time span of but a half a century. Stated in these terms, we know very little about the first 40 years, except at the end of them, advanced man had learned to use the skins of animals to cover them. Then about 10 years ago, under this standard, man emerged from his caves to construct other kinds of shelter. Only 5 years ago, man learned to write and use a cart with wheels. Christianity began less than 2 years ago. The printing press came this year. And then less than 2 months ago, during this whole 50-year span of human history,
if you press the center
the steam
or the,
engine provided a new source
trigger
of power.
You can move from seats to either watch the television gravity or
last month,
the projector screen.
Electric lights and telephones and automobiles and airplanes became available. Only last week did we develop penicillin and television and nuclear power. And now if America's new spacecraft succeeds in reaching Venus, we will have literally reached the stars before midnight tonight. This is a breathtaking
really cool to
pace.
Sit and watch the,
and such a pace cannot
the
help
projector and the projector
but
screen.
Create new ills,
yeah,
as it
pretty
dispels
awesome
old. New ignorance, new problems, new dangers. Surely the opening vistas of space promise high costs and hardships, as well as high reward. So it is not surprising that some would have us stay where we are a little longer, to rest, to wait. But this city of Houston, this state of Texas, this country of the United States was not built by those who waited and rested and wished to look behind them. For the eyes of the world now look into space, to the moon and to the planets beyond. And we have vowed that we shall not see it governed by a hostile flag of conquest, but by a banner of freedom and peace. The exploration of space will go ahead, whether we join in it or not. And it is one of the great adventures of all time. Those who came before us made certain that this country rode the first waves of the Industrial Revolution, the first waves of modern invention, and the first wave of nuclear power. And this generation does not intend to founder in the backwash of the coming age of space. We mean to be a part of it. We mean to lead it. Its hazards are hostile to us all. Its conquest deserves the best of all mankind. and its opportunity for peaceful cooperation may never come again. But why, some say, the moon? Why choose this as our goal? And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? Why 35 years ago, fly the Atlantic? Why does Rice play Texas? We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win on the other side.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
I think the momentous, most memorable thing that I can recall about that particular day was the opportunity while my two friends here were being put into the spacecraft to stand alone by myself out there and look at the rocket and the quietness and see the sun come up and the waves rolling in and the evidence of the millions of people watching, but nothing specific and just so quiet. Realize that indeed such a contrast was going to take place, all the frantic activity preparing the rocket, but it was so quiet up there for me personally, and that in a very few moments we were going to be departing in a great roar and off for a momentous event.
We had a 90% chance of getting back safely to Earth on that flight, but only a 50-50 chance of making a successful landing on the first attempt. There's so many unknowns in that descending from lunar orbit down to the surface that had not been demonstrated yet by testing. It's a risk-reward equation, and you're able to accept a level of risk so long as it's commensurate with the reward that you will get by achieving the goal which you're after.
T-minus 1 minute 35 seconds on the Apollo mission, the flight to land of the first men on the moon. All indications coming in to the control center at this time indicate we are go. 1 minute, 25 seconds and counting. Our status board indicates the third stage completely pressurized. 80-second mark has now been passed. We'll go on full internal power at the 50-second mark in the countdown. Guidance system goes on internal at 17 seconds, leading up to the ignition sequence at 8.9 seconds. We're approaching the 60-second mark on the Apollo 11 mission. T-minus 60 seconds and counting. We pass T-minus 60. 55 seconds and counting. Neil Armstrong just reported back. It's been a real smooth countdown. We passed the 50-second mark. Power transfer is complete. We're on internal power with the launch vehicle at this time. 40 seconds away from the Apollo 11 liftoff. All the second stage tanks now pressurized. 35 seconds and counting. We are still go with Apollo 11. 30 seconds and counting. Astronauts report it feels good. T-minus 25 seconds. 20 seconds and counting. T-minus 15 seconds. Guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9. Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11. Tower clear.
Here we got a roll program. Neil Armstrong reporting their roll and pitch program, which puts Apollo 11 on proper heading. Plus 30 seconds.
You see your city? So I certainly see mine.
I think certainly to go as far away as the moon and look back on the Earth certainly does affect your perspective. And then when you see it, tiny as your thumbnail held out in front of you at arm's length, that sort of gets your attention. A beautiful sight, tiny, pristine, blue and white, very fragile looking object, shining like a beautiful little headlight out there in the black velvet of space. It does change your perspective. It makes you think that we have to take better care of this little fragile entity, because it is fragile.
Apollo 11, this is Houston. Slightly less than 1 minute to ignition, and everything is go.
Roger, Apollo 11's go.
confirm ignition and the thrust is go. Apollo 11, this is Houston at 1 minute. Trajectory and guidance looks good and the stage is good.
Apollo 11.
We're showing velocity 35,570 feet per second.
Apollo 11, this is Houston. Around 3.5 minutes, you're still looking good. Your predicted cutoff is right on the nominal.
Roger, Apollo 11, go. We're showing velocity 35,570 feet per second. Altitude 177 nautical miles.
Apollo 11, this is Houston. You are go at 5 minutes.
Roger, Apollo 11, go.
Here we go.
Apollo 11, this is Houston. Your go for separation. As our system's recommendation is arm both pyro buses, over.
Okay, pyro B coming armed. My intent is to use bottle primary one as per the checklist, therefore I just turned A on.
Roger, we concur with the logic.
Roger. See, when you do this, you have to close one eye and look to the target. And mind you, when you do, when you are docking, you're not going for the center, you're actually going for the green target.
Okay, we got the Eagle in view.
Meters. 15 meters. 10 meters. 8 meters. 6. 5 meters. 3. 2 meters. 1 meter.
Give that another shot.
What did you do?
Zoom. What the fuck, man? I didn't even know you were in here.
All right, Neo, we need to rotate the spacecraft now.
Well, now I know you're not a ghost. Whew. No, I had, that's why I have headphones on.
Meters. 15 meters. 10 meters. 8 meters. 5 meters. 3, 2 meters. 1 meter. And capture.
Loud and clear now, Mike, and we understand that you are docked.
That's permanent. Houston, we're ready for limb ejection.
Roger, go for limb ejection.
Thank you.
Apollo 11, this is Houston, over.
Roger, Houston, Apollo 11, go ahead.
Roger, could you give us some comments on how the transposition and docking went, over?
Yeah, I thought it went pretty well, Houston, although I expect I used more gas than I've been using in the simulator. Except for using a little more gas, and I'd be interested in your numbers on that. Everything went nominally.
This is Houston. Roger, we copy.
Eagle, Houston, the alignment and the initialization look good to us, over.
Roger, thank you.
Eagle, Houston, would you have Columbia go to the high gain, yaw zero, pitch, minus 20, over. Apollo 11, Houston, we are go for undocking, over.
Roger, understand. Roger, Eagle for undock.
Roger, how does it look?
Eagle has wind.
Roger. Eagle, Houston, we see you on the steerable, over.
I do believe you got thrusters on board that vehicle.
Are you asleep?
Okay, you've got it. Do it, David.
Roger, let us know when you're ready to copy. We have a DOI pad and a PDI pad, over.
Guidance says we're going. Coming up on 5 minutes to ignition, Gene Kranz getting a go, no go for descent.
Okay, all flight controllers, I'm going around the horn. Just going to make your go, no go, based on the data you had for an LOS. See, we got it back. Give you another 2 seconds.
We're going, fly.
Okay, retro, go. Vital, go. Guide, go. Control, go. Self-com, go. GNC, go. Econ, go. Surgeon, go. Capcom, we're go to continue PDI.
Roger, understand, go for landing, 3,000 feet, shot alarm.
Forward, back, left, right. Hold to recenter. Hold for additional thrust. Oh, there's a trajectory phase. All right.
I got good signal strength and flu.
Yeah, you should have now, Houston.
Eagle, we got you now. It's looking good. Over. Eagle, Houston, after yaw around, angled S-band pitch, minus 9er, yaw, plus 1-8.
Altitude 5,200 feet.
Manual attitude control is good.
Roger, copy.
Altitude 4,200.
Houston, you're a go for landing, over.
Roger, interfering, go for landing, 3,000 feet. Stop alarm. 1201.
1201.
Roger, 1201 alarm. We're go, same type, we're go.
2,000 feet, 2,000 feet. Into the ag, 47 degrees.
Roger.
47 degrees.
Eagle looking great. Your go.
Altitude 1600. 1400 feet, still looking very good.
Roger, 1202, we copy it.
35 degrees. 35 degrees, 750, coming down to 23. 700 feet, 21 down, 33 degrees. 100 feet, down to 19. 540 feet, down to 30, and a 15. And 400 feet, down at 9. Gate forward. 1050 feet down at 4. 30, lift the half down. 8 on horizontal velocity. 1050 feet down 3.5. 47 forward. On 1.5 down. 70. Got this shadow out there. 50 down at 2.5. 19 forward. Altitude, velocity, light. 8.5 down. 220 feet. 13 forward. 11 forward, coming down nicely. 200 feet. 4.5 down. 5.5 down. Within 60, 6.5 down. 5.5 down. 9 forward. 20 feet. 100 feet, 3.5 down, 9 forward. 5%. On any bite? 375 feet. That is looking good, down a half. 6 forward.
60 seconds.
Lights on. Down 2.5. Forward. Forward. 40 feet down, 2.5. Picking up some dust. 30 feet, 2.5 down. Fake shadow. 4 forward. 4 forward, drifting to the right a little. Down a half.
30 seconds.
Forward. Contact light. Okay, engine stop. ATA at a descent. Post control, both auto descent, engine command override off. Engine arm off. 413 is in.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
I'm at the foot of the ladder. The LEM footbeds are only depressed in the surface about 1 or 2 inches, although the surface appears to be very, very fine-grained as you get close to it. It's almost like a powder. Ground mist is very fine. I'm going to step off the LEM now. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. Yes, the surface is fine and powdery. I can pick it up loosely with my toe. It does adhere to in fine layers, like powdered charcoal, to the sole and sides of my boot. I only go in a small fraction of an inch, maybe an eighth of an inch, but I can see the footprints of my boots and the treads in the fine sandy particles.
Neil, this is Houston. We're copying.
There seems to be no difficulty in moving around as we suspected. It's even perhaps easier than the simulations of 1/6G that we performed in various simulations on the ground. Absolutely no trouble to walk around.
hold to recenter, forward, back, left. All right. Oh, deploy experiments. Look for the following icons. I sound module.
Beautiful view. They got something? Magnificent sight out here. Magnificent desolation. It's quite dark here in the shadow and a little hard for me to see that I have good footing. I'll work my way over into the sunlight here without looking great.
The passive seismic experiment detected lunar moonquakes and provided information about the internal structure of the moon. This experiment studied the propagation of seismic waves through the moon and provided our most detailed look at the moon's internal structure. The Apollo 11 seismometer returned data for just 3 weeks, but provided a very useful look at lunar seismology. More advanced seismometers were deployed at the Apollo 12, 14, 15, and 16 landing sites and transmitted data to Earth until September 1977. Each of these seismometers measured all three components of ground displacement: up, down, north, south, and east, west. If a seismic event is observed by three or more seismometers, the time and location of the event can be determined. Because seismic waves from distant events travel deeper into the moon than waves from nearby events, by measuring events at various distances from the seismometer, one can determine how seismic velocities vary with depth in the moon. In turn, this information can be used to study the moon's internal structure. Most of the events observed by the seismometers were due either to moonquakes or to meteorite impacts. However, the third stages of several Saturn V rockets and the ascent stages of several lunar modules were deliberately crashed into the moon after these spacecraft were no longer needed. These man-made crashes produced seismic events of known times and locations and helped to calibrate the network of seismometers.
Start to lose my balance in one direction, and recovery is quite natural and very easy. And moving arms around, Jack doesn't dot the surface. Not quite that light-footed. You have to be careful that you're leaning in the direction you want to go, otherwise you slightly inebriate. In other words, you have to cross your foot over to stay underneath where your center of mass is.
The Lunar Flag Assembly, or LFA, was a kit containing a flag of the United States, designed to be planted by astronauts on the moon during the Apollo program. Seven such flag assemblies were sent to the moon, six of which were planted, the exception being the one carried on Apollo 13, which had to abort its landing due to a serious spacecraft failure. The nylon flags were hung on telescoping staffs and horizontal bars constructed of 1-inch anodized aluminium tubes. The flags were carried on the outside of the Apollo lunar module, most of them on the descent ladder inside a thermally insulated tubular case to protect them from exhaust gas temperatures calculated to reach 2000 degrees Fahrenheit or 1090 degrees Celsius. Six of the flags were ordered from a government supply catalogue and measured 3 feet by 5 feet. The last one planted on the moon was slightly larger, at 6 foot wide, the flag which had hung in the mission operations control room in the manned spacecraft centre for most of the Apollo programme. This is the solar wind composition experiment. The sun continually emits a flux of electrically charged particles into space. This is termed the solar wind. The Earth's magnetic field prevents these charged particles from reaching the Earth's surface, although in the Earth's polar regions, these particles can reach the upper part of the atmosphere, causing auroras. The moon is outside the Earth's magnetic field for most of each month and has a negligible atmosphere, allowing solar wind particles to reach the moon's surface. The solar wind composition experiment was performed on Apollo 11, 12, 14, 15 and 16. It consisted of an aluminium foil sheet 1.4 metres by 0.3 metres that was deployed on a pole facing the sun. This foil was exposed to the sun for periods ranging from 77 minutes on Apollo 11 to 45 hours on Apollo 16, allowing solar wind particles to embed themselves into the foil. The foil was then returned to Earth for laboratory analysis. This allowed the chemical composition of the embedded solar wind to be determined more accurately than would be possible if the measurement were made using remotely controlled instruments on the moon, but limited the periods at which observations could be made.
Something interesting in the bottom of this little crater here.
Tranquility Base, this is Houston. Can we get both of you on the camera for a minute, please?
I'd like to evaluate the various spaces that a person can traveling on the surface. Oh, that looks beautiful from here, Neil.
It has a stark beauty all its own. It's like much of the high desert of the United States. It's different, but it's very pretty out here. Something interesting in the bottom of this little crater here.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, if you look here, you get to the bottom of the crater, you find a lot of cool stuff.
My father gave a copy of the Desiderata to each of us kids to hang on our bedroom walls.
Are you getting a TV picture now, Houston?
Neil, yes, we are getting a TV picture. Neil, this is Houston. We're getting a picture. You're not in at the present time. We can see the bag on the LEC being moved by Buzz, though. Here you come into our field of view.
I want to back up and partially close that. Making sure not to lock it on my way out. Noticed several times in going from the sunlight into shadow that just as I go in, I catch an additional reflection off the lamp that, along with the reflection off my face onto the visor, makes visibility very poor just at the transition sunlight into the shadow. I essentially have so much glare coming onto my visor, I'm in shadow, until the helmet actually gets shadow, and then it takes a short while for my eyes to adapt to the lighting condition.
We fly all the way to the moon to get our source from Wikipedia.
Inside the shadow area.
Neil, this is Houston, radio check, over.
Hi, Roger. Houston, loud and clear.
Roger out.
Loud and clear, Houston.
Roger, Buzz. Neil, this is Houston. Based on your camera transfer with the LEC, do you foresee any difficulties in SRC transfer? Over.
Difficulties in SR.
Negative.
I get so Neil is now unveiling the plaque.
For those who haven't read the plaque, we'll read the plaque that's on the front landing gear.
Tranquility Base, Houston.
Roger, go ahead.
Roger, our guidance recommendation is pings, and you're cleared for takeoff.
Roger, understand. We're number one on the runway.
Roger.
This nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. No single space project in this period will be more impressive to mankind or more important for the long-range exploration of space, and none will be so difficult or expensive to accomplish.
Man, that was intense.